Hi, this is Aaron Newkman. On this episode of Floss Weekly, Jonathan Bennett joins me to talk about Midokura. It's based on the open source project MidoNet, or MidoNet, as you would say in Japan. And it is a virtual network management system. You're not going to want to miss it. It's coming up right now on Floss Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Floss Weekly is provided by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Floss Weekly with Aaron Newkman and Jonathan Bennett, episode 402, recorded on September 6, 2016, Midokura. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Floss Weekly. I'm your host, Aaron Newkman. Thanks for joining, as always. This is a show about open source software, open source hardware, and the people that make those things. So welcome aboard. As usual, I am joined by a lovely co-host. And this week, again, that co-host is Jonathan Bennett. Jonathan, welcome back.
Hey, Aaron. It's good to be here. Yes, I have the curse and blessing of always being available. So when something happens last minute, I'm the one that gets to do it, but that's all right. I enjoy it. It's good to be here.
That's okay. You know, you've been doing great on these shows as co-host, and so glad to have you aboard, and glad that you're available, because all of us are so busy. It's sometimes just difficult to get a hold of someone. It's like, oh, I've got to go to work. Oh, I'm traveling. I think there was three or four people traveling today. So I said, Jonathan, can you help us out again, please? And you were so nice to say yes. So thank you very much for that. And you're speaking to us from your secret lair, I see, your dark lair of office-ness.
Yes, the home office here in Lawton, Oklahoma, which is recently becoming earthquake territory, although I was asleep and didn't feel a thing. But apparently all over the United States, people felt the earthquake from right here in Oklahoma. So that's your Oklahoma trivia for the day.
Wow. When was this? I didn't feel it.
It was Friday or Saturday, I think. Like I said, it was like 7 or 8 in the morning here, so I was still in bed asleep. It was one of my days off. But wow. Yeah, it was like a 5.6 up about 100 miles north of us here.
Oh, wow. That's weird. I mean, for Oklahoma especially. We, of course, here in the Bay Area, we have earthquakes all the time. It's not that we don't feel them because we're sleeping. We don't feel them because we're used to them. It's like, maybe that was something. I don't know. You know, happens all the time. It actually does happen all the time. If you go look at the U.S. Geological Survey and look at the earthquake activity around here, it's like, you know, I don't know, 5 or 6 a day. Little ones way deep underground, you know, little 4.0s or 4.5s. It's a little crazy, but Oklahoma, that's news,
well,
man.
It's not the first time it's happened. And, you know, some people say that, well, it's because of all the oil drilling and the fracking, and that maybe, I don't know. But it's historically, it's happened for Oklahoma to have small tremors before. So it's not the end of the world or the signs of the times.
Yeah. Wow. I did want to mention before we get started, I was on the new Screensavers on Saturday, and we talked to the high seas folks, and I don't mean the Kool-Aid type drink, but actually the Hawaiian, I forget what it stands for, Hawaiian something, 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 but so out in Hawaii, they put up this dome for a pretend mission to Mars, and they put it up on this crater, and they lived there for a year inside the dome to simulate what would happen on a mission to Mars and what kind of problems could, you know, come up and arise and all these things. And so they had to stay in this 1,200 square foot dome with 6 people for a year. Of course, they did like spacewalks in Hawaii and things like that. I asked them if they got down to the beach at all. I guess they didn't. But anyway, they emulated this, and really cool. If you look at the scenery and everything around there, it actually looks like Mars. Really cool thing. So if you missed the new Screensavers, go back and watch it. It was a really fun time with Leo and the new Screensavers talking about that. And it actually related to that. Guillermo brought this to my attention this morning. A few episodes ago, 20 episodes ago or so, or maybe more than that, actually. I think it was episode 341, according to my notes. We had a project on called SatNogs, S-A-T-N-O-G-S. And they were putting together an open source software and open source hardware satellite to send up to the International Space Station. And they actually did that. The satellite's there. So it's the first open source, open hardware satellite, at least to go to space. And maybe John can bring up that page if we're lucky. I know I'm bringing them, surprising him with that request there. but I'm looking at the page now, and it's been delivered. It's really cool looking thing. It's black, and it's, you know, they have to put those things in a delivery package. So it's like a cube size thing. Oh, there it is. Thank you, John. It's like a little rectangle, black rectangle with all of the different components in that. And really interesting engineering problem to solve when you're designing something to go into space. You can't just like, you know, put it in a project box. You have to actually put it inside something that'll fit in the delivery there, the payload mechanism. And so, so that's what they did. So congratulations to those guys. And if you missed that episode, please go back and listen to it. It was episode 344, episode 341, and SatNogs. You can just do a search for, twit.tv, SatNogs, or do a search for Floss Weekly SatNogs, and you'll find it pretty easily on Google, on a Google search. Okay, we're not here to talk about satellites in space, although it's really fun and we love to do it. We're here to talk about networking and network management. So we're going to be bringing on Midokura, or the company I believe is called Midokura, and the project is called MidoNet. Jonathan, do you know anything about either of those, Midokura or the open source project that they use, MidoNet?
I know they're looking at something called software-defined networking. And when I first heard about software-defined networking, my first thought was, well, that sounds like a buzzword. It must not really mean anything. And then I read a little bit more about it, and I went, oh, that's VLANs. And then I read a little bit more about it, and I went, no, there might be something more to this than just buzzwords and VLANs. So I'm looking forward to learning about it as well.
It does sound a bit like a little bit like magic or special sauce or something that doesn't really exist. But we use the term in my industry, we use the term software defined storage as well. And it's very similar to software defined networking. And so, you know, we use that all the time. It's one of the hot buzzwords in the industry, or was a few years ago. And so we'll definitely ask our guest about that. This is actually a really hot topic with all of the things that are going on in terms of, containers. We talk about containers all the time on the show now. Virtual networks, all of those things. You need to find a good way to manage that. And so I'm really anxious to actually see what they're doing in this area. Also, before we get too far, I don't want to forget, I know everyone's asking about Randall. I didn't mention him at the top of the show because I wanted to sit for here. So Randall's going to be back next week. If you've been following along, you know on our schedule, Josh Berkus is going to be here next week talking about his new project. And Randall is well enough. I think he's getting discharged today. And so he's going to be joining us next week to talk to Josh Berkus. And I'm going to do the heavy lifting for that episode, kind of ease him back into things here. So he's going to be the co-host for once. He hasn't been a co-host in a long time. So that'll be interesting. But he's going to be back next week. So for all of those out there who've been asking on IRC and sending emails and things, when's Randall coming back? When's Randall coming back? He's well enough and he's coming back next week. So we're really looking forward to getting him back on the show. And I know you are as well. All right. So let's talk about our guest today. So we're going to be bringing on in just a minute, Pino da Candia. He is the CTO of Midokura, responsible for their technical innovation and the evolution of their flagship technology and open source project, by the way, called MidoNet. He joined Midokura as a software engineer in 2010, so he's been there for quite a while, and he built the early versions of MidoNet and led the network controller team as engineering lead and the architecture team as the chief architect from Barcelona, which I believe he's calling us from today. So let's bring him on. Let's bring on Pino. Pino, are you there?
I am. Thanks for having me on the show. This is very exciting.
All right. Yeah, thanks for joining us today. So you are calling us or speaking to us from Barcelona, correct?
That's right. That's right. We're in Barcelona. Midokura has about 22 people here in Barcelona, and we have also have smaller offices in San Francisco and Tokyo.
Ah, so this isn't just, you know, you're not in just a garage somewhere working on this. You've actually been working on this for quite a while.
That's right. That's right. We got started in 2010 in Japan, and late 2011, I came on in late 2010, and in late 2011, we hired a few more people here in Barcelona, and from then, we've sort of grown.
Great. Well, tell us about, first of all, tell us about the relationship between Midokura and MidoNet, because I may have botched it up when I was introducing you, but is Midokura a company and then MidoNet is the open source project? Did I get that right?
That's exactly right, and you did great. So actually, a lot of people use the pronunciation MidoNet. I say MidoNet. I'll just say, because it's fun, that Midokura comes from Japanese words Mido, green, like Midori, and Kura, which is cloud, or sort of the technical cloud. So Midokura. And so it's correct, Midokura is the company, MidoNet is the open source project, which we originally developed closed source, and we open source at the end of 2014. And I think there's a lot to talk about there in terms of how that sort of process goes and how things go when you take what was originally meant to be closed source and open source it and the pain points there. But I think we'll get into that later on. So I'll tell you a little bit about the company and what we were trying to achieve, and then the open source project and not just MidoNet, but others, but one other in particular comes out of that. The founders of the company wanted to build a public cloud in Japan modeled on AWS. And so they got some seed funding and they started to play with software and starting to think through their plans. And as they built their prototype cloud, they found that it was a pain. This was early 2010, and they were looking at all the cloud management software out there. So at the time, you had things like CloudStack, OpenStack was just getting started, and Nebula, Eucalyptus. And okay, try some of those out, and you say, okay, well, you know, what do you need to start a cloud? And if you model on AWS and you want to start out with something similar, you're going to need object management right off the bat. So object management and block storage as well, so that you can move the VMs around without losing their state. And the networking, of course, that you can isolate tenants from each other. So at the time, and I think things haven't changed that much, but at the time, the really big challenges in building your own cloud were storage, and you talked about software-defined storage earlier, and networking. So the founders scrapped their idea of running a public cloud and decided to focus on building software-defined networking for virtualized workloads. I can keep going, so just chime in, I'll just sort of go on.
No, this is exactly what I was just going to ask you. Well, tell us about what the project is and what it does, and you're actually answering that question, so please keep going.
Okay, great. So this is now we're sort of still at the beginning. It's sort of mid 2010, and they have a prototype. And so what is the goal before we talk about? I haven't said which platform or which platform, but what is virtualized workload? So at the time, really, containers didn't come into the picture. It's VMs. And so you look at what people are running in the data center. And I'm going to say, we talked about software-defined networking. It means a lot of things. We're focused on software-defined networking for the data center, and particularly for virtual workloads, because you can do software-defined WAN. If you want to go outside the data center, you can do software-defined fabrics, and there are lots of other products. But we really looked at sort of people running VMs, and even in systems, so you know, look at a typical system, VMware, 70% of the virtualization market, and what are they doing? They're running VLANs. And Jonathan, by the way, you did great, great introduction to software-defined networking, because it's exactly, as you said, you know, so we run VMs, the VMs, for a long time, we're just deployed as closely as possible to the way we're deploying servers. And that's not just in terms of, so you want the networking to work the same way, the storage to work the same way. But then what about the human processes? So you file a ticket to get a VM. You file a ticket to get the VM placed behind a load balancer, and so on. So even though you now virtualize your compute and your utilization is great, but you're still not agile. So one piece of that is, what's your flexibility in terms of how your networking is set up? How much interaction do you have to have with the networking team? What components you have to deploy, hardware or software, into the network as you roll out new applications? So the goal was, from the very beginning, to allow the application's networking to be defined independently of the physical networking. That's the goal we set out with. So what does that mean? It means that you can, if you look at a picture of a data center and physical workloads, you have subnets, you have layer two networks, you have VLANs, but that's because you want to have isolation and segmentation of the layer two networks. So let's ignore that from the application standpoint. If there are two networks, they have subnets, you've got routing, you've got load balancers, you've got VPNs, you've got firewalls, and so on. So can we do all this independently of the physical network? Now, first, why would you want to do it independently of the physical network? Well, this is important because you eliminate the interactions with the network team. You simplify the physical network. The physical network shouldn't be changing as applications move around. As today, a container moves from point A to point B. The physical network doesn't need to change. And the same is true in infrastructure as a service, meaning virtual machine environments. So you simplify operations and you minimize points where your infrastructure will break. So we started out with a goal of just IP fabrics. That's all you need. Why? 2010, IP fabric is pretty easy to use. I mean, yes, you have to have network engineers that really know what they're doing, but you know, you pick your vendor and people can keep IP networks up stable with quality of service. They can scale them. People started talking, I think the term CLOS fabric started coming up more and more. This is in around 2010, 2011. Everyone started to understand this idea of a spine and leaf. That's another term for a CLOS fabric. Essentially, you're creating a very a network with a, we talk about cross-section bandwidth, but basically how much traffic can you carry? And essentially, you're building a very big switch, but it's cheap because you're taking commodity switches and putting them together in a mesh. So this is not just your hub and spoke. This is a very dense mesh so that you have a lot of cross-section bandwidth.
So that's really interesting, Pino. It does kind of sound like a little bit like infrastructure as a service here. So everything is standardized. We've followed our best practices from a network standpoint, and we put in this network in a very standardized way that we know works and is protected and highly secure and whatever else. And then we add this virtual layer on top of it. Doesn't that introduce some latencies? I mean, whenever you put something in between point A and point B, there's always a little bit of a time lag. So how are we not compromising the speed of the network at this point?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Let me say, when you say it sounds like infrastructure as a service, absolutely. Network as a service, we think, is a fundamental component of infrastructure as a service. If you have self-service compute, you need to have self-service network. Now, to your question about latency. So yes, it's true that you get added latency somewhere. Another question is how, and so yes, that's true. And we've been addressing that in the follow-up in the years since we started. And different segments of the industry have addressed it in different ways. So for example, there's a lot of hypervisor-based switching now. So we have a software switch in every hypervisor to do things like network policies and security policy at the edge. And the way in which we address latency is by using projects, open source projects like Intel's DPDK, Intel's Data Plane Development Kit, which works with not just with Intel chips, but with a variety of other vendors' chips. And that accelerates the networking various ways. So instead of doing, for example, software interrupts to receive and process packets, it has you can pin cores to your networking. So I can explain that without waving my hands quite as much. But the point I wanted to make is that yes, you're right initially, and all the vendors have been addressing the particular latencies that their systems introduced. I'll give you another example that's more specific to Midokura. So we made a trade-off very early on. Our goal was to make it possible for people to not have any bottlenecks and any single points of failure in layer 2, layer 3, and layer 4 networking. So again, I mean Ethernet, IP, UDP, TCP. So what did this mean? Traditionally, when you run a network and a virtual network in particular, you're going to run a component. You're going to say, okay, I've got a router instance. So where does that router instance live? If it's and you know, just as an example, so you have clarify ideas. You might run a little Linux namespace. Today we call that a container, but we've been using namespaces for longer than containers were popular. And that namespace would be an isolated Linux router. But we could also use the Quagga routing stack to do things like OSPF and BGP and other dynamic routing protocols. Those things need to live somewhere. Now, if it's a control protocol like BGP, it's not so bad if you put it in one particular server. But if instead you're running it as the data plane for some application, it means that a VM in rack 1 needs to send its traffic to rack 2 for the traffic to be routed by a Linux router that's in a namespace there on one of the servers in rack 2. And then that namespace might route it back to rack 1 to reach the final, the final destination, some other VM that VM1 is talking to. So you just did, we call this a traffic trombone. You're going out to one place just to get some network service and coming back. Now, if you think about all the things in the path between two VMs, you'll encounter things like your tenant router, because you need to have your own router that you control, whether you have direct access to it or it's implicitly built for you. You have a router for your project or your tenant. And then you'll go through a firewall, a load balancer. Those are often embedded in your tenant router, but not always, because they might be, for example, some layer 7 or some vendor provided function. And then you're going to go to the other, possibly to another router that belongs to a different tenant, a different project, a different organization in the same cloud, before you go down to their layer 2 and to the final VM. So you end up bouncing around the network a few times. So what we did was we said, well, if we're virtualizing, we don't actually need to use a namespace. We don't actually need to run a router somewhere. We can have the model of a router in our software switch directly. So in the software switch of the VM, we know what the virtual network needs to look like, because it's not the physical network, it's just a model. You created the model as you built out your OpenStack cloud or your vSphere or your container connectivity. You built out the model. We understand the model. And the model is distinct from the physical layer. It's completely abstracted. So for us, it's just a set of objects in a database that describe what you want your network behavior, what your network graph to look like, and what the network behavior should be. So we pull those models onto the host, and we know exactly how, what services the packet should be should traverse on its way to the destination. So when we actually forward the packet from one hypervisor to another, you'll see on the physical wire that the packet is encapsulated, but it's going from the source hypervisor through some top of rack switch, through some spine, to another top of rack switch, and it finally reaches its destination. That's one traversal of the CLOSS fabric or the spine and leaf fabric that I mentioned earlier. But if you looked at the virtual topology, we would tell you, oh, by the way, you went through a port-level firewall that was protecting your VM from anti-spoofing and possibly applying some ACLs that you configured. Then you went through the the bridge to the route, to the router, to your router, and in the router you match a specific route. Out of that route sent you onto a common public network, and from that public network to the other, and so on. So that one traffic flow, encapsulated traffic flow, is actually representing a very complex traversal of multiple logical devices. What does that allow us to do? Two things. One is we made one network hop when some of our competitors or some of the other models require multiple hops around the physical infrastructure. And because we also are doing this all as sort of a model of a network graph, we can also take note of exactly where how you're traversing, so that if you think the network isn't behaving exactly as you thought you configured it, you can look at a flow record that doesn't just have the packet signature. It tells you exactly what elements you traversed, and you might say, "Oh, I didn't realize I was going to get hit. I'm hitting that that rule. I didn't expect to hit that rule. That's wrong." Or vice versa, the packet was allowed. I thought I had placed my rules correctly. Configured my ACLs correctly to block such traffic. Now I know it's not matching. Here's why.
Cool. Great. That's awesome. And this, what does this do for the you talked about, and I'm going to key on the word agility that you mentioned before as a way for you to explain this. What does this do for the business then? So I'm a big business. I need to set things up quickly in my data center, and I submit a ticket, and it takes 2 weeks for them to get this done because they have to wait for some downtime to, you know, hook up a new cable or something for my server, to get my database online, to get my application running. Maybe I just answered the question. What does this do for the actual business? What benefit does it bring them if you're looking at setting up especially a large networking infrastructure like this?
Yeah, you're exactly right. So the fact that you now have APIs that can configure the networking, the fact that you have, and so it's connectivity APIs, it's security policy APIs, and you can have sort of multiple levels of intent. So OpenStack has policy projects, a few different policy projects. So you can sort of control the networking from a more abstract layer. So this certainly speeds up organizations. Now, in practice, this is not entirely true because there's the lag of human processes. So we still see organizations that will deploy OpenStack, but only for the IT team to become more agile and to reduce the time it takes them to provide a VM or a set of VMs to their customers. And they're not really opening up the OpenStack deployment to their internal teams as direct access to the UI, direct user provisioning, and that's due both to internal processes and maybe a little bit immaturity of the product of the project. But then again, they're not doing that on VMware either. So there's a lot of stickiness. You know, the teams want to have control. There are a lot of processes that don't migrate to the cloud because they haven't even been considered in the cloud yet. So that'll take some time. That said, there's a wide spectrum of organizations that, you know, they use a system like OpenStack or even the container frameworks like Kubernetes and Mesos, and they use them in very agile ways. And then you have, at the other end of the spectrum, folks that are experimenting with that, but they still are limiting what their teams, the developers and production teams, can actually do with them.
Hello, Pino. It's good to talk to you. We have a question from the chat room, actually. Esol wants to know, it sounds like MidoNet is great for virtual machines in containers. Is there a use case for MidoNet as the heart of my physical machines, maybe all the way to my edge router?
Great. I'm glad you asked that. We've lagged in providing this kind of functionality. So because our architecture is based on having a software switch, a daemon running in the hypervisor or the container node. I'm talking to this, when I said talking, not in the container, but in the container host. We essentially need to be in the server. So we haven't had, for a long time, we didn't have a hardware switch-based agent. Or we didn't control the hardware switch. Now, what we started to do, this was early last year, is we started to experiment with putting an agent in hardware switches, and usually the fabric that provided connectivity for our servers, for servers running MidoNet. And the main purpose was for visibility. So there are white box switches out there. White box switches essentially are commodity hardware. They're open switches. So traditionally, is it okay if I go on a detour about white box switches quickly?
Oh, sure. Go for it.
So, because I think it fits very well in this idea, you know, in the open source mentality. The idea was that previously vendors would deliver a switch and you got a CLI, and other than that, you really didn't get to run anything of your own on that switch. And you could use tools like SNMP, the Simple Network Management Protocol, to query state from the switch. That was pretty much it. With the white box switching, a few things happened. One is we're going to commodity switching chips. And the other is that then software vendors put a layer they put a network operating system on top of that. So examples of network operating systems are Cumulus Linux or Pika 8. What is a network operating system? Not everyone does it the same way, but basically you get a Linux or a modified version of Linux. And you can interact with that modified version of Linux. So Cumulus Linux, for example, you're really writing your network configuration in standard Linux. Another vendor that does something similar is Sixwind. They also translate, this is also used on the server side, by the way, but they translate essentially what are Linux network configuration onto whatever hardware you have, whether it's an Intel chip or a Mellanox chip and so on. Now, what that means is then you can write your own programs to run on that switch. So you'll deploy Cumulus Linux or any of their competitors. You create a fabric, and then you can run your own. You know, if the vendor is not fast enough in providing something to you, you can write your own software that does some sort of control plane algorithm or some additional monitoring you wanted, and then of course you can invite. You can put other vendors on the platform. So that's the model that we've adopted, where on Cumulus Linux or Pika 8, et cetera, we can put a MidoNet agent. So getting back to this, to the viewer's question, we started experimenting with putting MidoNet on these open switches. And it was purely to collect information from the chip. Now, the chips need to be enabled in the right way to give you visibility. And there's a question of what drivers and so on. In the early phases, we had to access registers, but the chip vendors, Broadcom, for example, has now Broadview, which is a framework where you can query. You have a very nice SDK, and you can query what's happening down at the chip level, and you can find out what's happening. Is it congestion? Were there packet drops? You can even ask, this is more related to Cumulus Linux, it happens at in the network operating system, but you can ask, if a packet came in with this signature into this port on the switch, where would it be routed? Out of which of the other ports would it egress? So then so having these capabilities, we were able to build tools that do the following. They'll, you know, display the graph of the physical fabric. They will show you in a color that a port or a switch is experiencing drops or congestion. And this is still prototype, but we could take a tunneled flow, meaning an overlay flow, a flow between two virtual machines, and we could figure out exactly what path it took on the physical fabric, so that we would show that, for example, it might have gone through a congested or a port that was dropping packets. And the really cool thing, again, this is still prototype, but we're able to do things like, if you see congestion on a queue, on a packet queue inside the switch, then you can ask, why am I seeing congestion? Let's start taking samples and see if we can find a culprit. Maybe there's what's called an elephant flow. So elephant flows are these flows that either last a long time, but generally their elephant flows are moving enough packets that they could on their own fill up the packet buffers in the switches. And if you have one of these elephant flows, essentially because of how TCP works, they just push until they start to experience congestion, and then they back off. And so you will see packet drops, or at least queue lengths increasing on the switches. So what can you do then? You can sort of, if you can identify who that is, you can apply a quality of service to that flow. So you can say that specific flow, that should be quarantined. Let's put it in its own queue, and it gets a lower priority because it's interfering with other traffic. So all of this to say that we started experimenting with putting an agent on these switches, and we're now becoming familiar with these switches so that we can start to do actual configuration of the switches. So that's one path, one way in which we'll start to move towards controlling physical fabrics. Another way is that the switches have implemented. So there's a really important project in the software defined networking space called Open vSwitch, and Open vSwitch is very popular in the OpenStack project. And Open vSwitch, I should also add, was created by a company previously called Nisira, which was acquired by VMware. So and that company or those people ended up building NSX, VMware's networking, VMware's newest networking. So the point there is to say that, I lost my train of thought. Open vSwitch.
Open VS. OVS. I was going to ask about that anyway. Yeah. Since you're on the, I was going to say, I'm pretty sure OpenStack has some of this functionality built into OVS already, don't they? How do you interoperate with that, or do you?
Yeah, so let me explain that. When you hear about Open vSwitch in OpenStack, what they're saying is that there's an implementation of their networking functionality that is backed by Open vSwitch plus a whole bunch of other software that OpenStack brings to the table to augment it. Open vSwitch is just a software switch that runs on a hypervisor or a container hypervisor. And Open vSwitch is Open vSwitch comes from it turns these hypervisors into switches, so you can do switching for your local VMs. Why is that important? Because if you don't have a software switch, every packet has to go out to the through the NIC, the physical NIC, out to the top of rack, and out to the physical network to get service somewhere there. And so many vendors did take that approach, where they sort of said, "I'm going to do all the virtual networking in the physical network, and not modify your hypervisor." So you do have to have this kind of, I'm forgetting the term now, but basically you have to sort of leave the physical host and come back in, even if you have traffic between two VMs, in order to apply certain functions, like even security security rules. If you have a software switch, you can apply your software policies at the edge, meaning in the hypervisor. So Open vSwitch is pretty much the dominant software switch. There have been competitors or great open source projects like Snob Switch. Also, there's one called Logopus, and there are others. But Open vSwitch is really the dominant one, and it introduced this idea. You know, before Open vSwitch, you had Linux bridging. But if you have a Linux bridge, if you want to create a virtual network with Linux bridge, you're composing layer two, composing bridges and routers. The Open vSwitch is flow based. You can basically take a packet and you can make arbitrary transformations in the packet. That means you can do much more advanced networking functions with that approach. You can modify with one operation on the packet. You can modify a bunch of different fields: layer two fields, layer three fields, layer four fields. So you're actually operating on a flow as if you were a composition of traditional network functions. So getting back to OpenStack, Open vSwitch is sort of the traditional reference solution for networking in OpenStack. The reason that there's been a whole community of vendors growing up in OpenStack, and particularly the networking project is called Neutron. I think you've talked about this on some of your other shows, on your previous shows. The reason the vendors came in is that reference implementation did have a lot of problems early on. Lots of components, single points of failure, operationally difficult. It's been improving, but vendors and other open source projects like ours were able to come in and address specific, address scale, address ease of operation, address high availability. And so that was our, and latency and so on. And so that was how the vendors got in. Also, I want to make a distinction between Neutron and the reference implementations of Neutron. So Neutron for me, and for us at Midokura, and I'd say this is true, this must be true of a lot of the vendors and open source projects that implement Neutron. For us, Neutron is a great API. It's an API for doing networking. So it's a way to express network concepts. how you actually implement those network concepts, well, there are lots of different ways provided by different vendors and different open source projects. So in fact, MidoNet, in many of its applications, so for example, in Kubernetes, we chose to use Neutron as our API. And there are two reasons for that. Well, Neutron is a standard API. And I'll say that for a while, people would say something like, Neutron is the dominant API to describe virtual networks. Now, it's not, you know, may not be targeted for certain things like software-defined WAN, but it does describe virtual machine and container networking. And so so it was a dominant API for networking. Although later you might say, people sort of say, well, but do we really need to describe networks at this very detailed, you know, with so much detail? Why should I, as an application, if I'm an application owner or operator or developer, why should I understand concepts like what a bridge is? How does a router behave? What's an ARP table? What's a multicast? What's multicast? And so on. I really only want to know the concept of an IP address, and maybe even that, even IP addresses and TCP ports and UDP ports, are really not really important. In fact, if you look at systems like platforms as a service, like so PaaS, platform as a service, like Cloud Foundry and others, where you just give them code, and they go and put that code inside some sort of box, some kind of a software box, you know, a container. Usually not a VM, but they put it inside a container, and they guarantee certain properties about how the code can interact with other tenants or other users' code. But you don't even have to worry about networking at all, right? So now, obviously, as these projects get more advanced functionality, you'll deal with networking in some way. You might want to know a dependency graph or a graph of interactions, and you might want to apply policy on that. But I think this was an interesting distinction between the infrastructure as a service and the container as a service. The container as a service, meaning Kubernetes, Swarm, Mesos, from the very beginning, they came up with a very simple network model, and they just said, that's going to be the network model. And that simplicity allows their customer, their users, to not have to worry about what the network looks like too much. You know, you just sort of you have some load balancing, you have DNS, so you know, naming service and service discovery, and you don't have to worry about how did I compose my network and what rules. But even Kubernetes and the others are now starting to build security policies. So they're not letting you tweak the connectivity so much. You don't have so much control over the connectivity, and that's a good thing, because why would you, without being a networking expert, want to reconfigure a network graph? But you do want to apply policies about which of my services deployed in Kubernetes can talk to my other services deployed in Kubernetes. So I took a little bit of a detour, but getting back to Neutron, the dominant API, and so we chose in the project Courier. Courier is a project that open source project in the OpenStack tent, OpenStack family, that we led. And the goal there was to bring Neutron networking to Kubernetes and eventually to Docker. We're working on Kubernetes now and eventually to others. And the idea is that with an integration of Kubernetes with Neutron via Courier, we bring the whole family of OpenStack SDNs into the container space, and that means that we all do things and we can collaborate, we can do things in a similar way, we can have the network behavior be somewhat standardized instead of sort of everyone doing it their own way. If you look at Kubernetes and when you look at how the networking is actually implemented, you see big differences about what's actually happening under the covers. That may not matter when things are working, but if you start to debug why there's latency or why flows are allowed or not, or why connectivity broke, then you start to have to understand the model. And we think that standardization, sort of having a common model and API at that layer helps.
Mm-hmm. So let's switch gears just a little bit. So part your model is to kind of take everything and put it on the same fabric so that from VM to VM and machine to machine, it's kind of all standardized. Doesn't that introduce kind of its own cornucopia of security problems? because everything is now kind of mixed together? And alternatively, if it doesn't, do you then have yet another layer of security to worry about? Kind of underneath this, you've still got the physical connections in between.
Okay, so let's see. So I think at the physical layer, you keep things simple because the VMs can't actually interact with the physical layer. They don't see the host. They don't see the network switches. So their traffic is overlaid on the physical fabric. So from that point of view, you've taken your VMs and they just have no way of talking to the physical layer. Now, if you're in your own data center, you'll use things like a layer 2 gateway or some other kinds of gateways where you say, I actually have a physical workload. I want to connect to my VMs and I want to allow that explicitly. But if you're a public cloud provider using OpenStack, you will or Kubernetes, you've taken the pods in the case of Kubernetes, the VMs in the case of OpenStack, and you've lifted them up, and you've sort of said, you know, you can't interact with the physical fabric. Also, because you have a very powerful software switch with a very powerful network model, so we've built things like port mirroring and service chaining, and we can do things like take the traffic. So in the case of port mirroring, we can take traffic from a virtual machine and make a copy, and we can send it to another virtual machine that might be a security appliance. So in fact, Midokura has a partnership with a team at Intel that has an open source project called the Open Security Controller. So Intel's Open Security Controller, its mission is to bring advanced security to virtualized workloads. Now, in the past, if you wanted to have your virtual machine traffic protected by a next generation firewall, you'd have to have the traffic go out to a VLAN, goes into the physical fabric, and you would set up the routing so that that traffic would actually go to a physical firewall. So you can see that that's not an easy process because you're actually having to, as applications move or as you deploy new applications, you're actually having to provision, change things on the physical fabric. Instead, why don't we deploy security functions as virtual machines or as containers? And that's the vision that they're working on. Where we've come in is that once they've deployed a security function, they need to sort of tell us, they need to say, tell MidoNet to send traffic that's about to arrive at the VM to have it do a detour and go through the security appliance first. And if the security appliance allows it, it comes back out and then we give it to the VM. So that's the concept of service insertion or service chaining. Whether you send you actually send the actual packet or you send a copy. In the case of a copy, we'll be talking about intrusion detection as opposed to intrusion prevention.
All right. So Pino, I read something on the website about the ability that MidoNet has to scrub incoming traffic. I think the idea was to look at stuff coming in on WAN pipes, and to get rid of all of the noise coming in off the internet. Is this something that you would refer to kind of as a software-defined firewall or software-defined perimeter?
I guess you could say that. People don't really say software-defined firewall, but you know, So what is it? It's a virtualized firewall. So there are a few things. So when we're scrubbing, if you use the term scrubbing traffic, you're really doing some function that requires what people call DPI, deep packet inspection. So MidoNet itself doesn't actually do that deep packet inspection, but I was talking about the open security controller there, and what MidoNet can do is it can redirect the flow to a VM orchestrated by a container orchestrated by the open security controller. So the idea is that, maybe I'll take a step back and say, I was explaining earlier that before, if you wanted to have your traffic protected, you had to make sure it went through physical firewalls. So the open security controller is this brings to the table that you can finally protect your VMs without having to use physical devices. And that's important because what actually ended up happening was people would really be really careful about which workloads should I send through the physical firewall, because you know, and you had the DMZ and you were really careful because it would introduce latency and it would introduce complexity, because you'd have to modify the physical networking every time you deployed a new application that needed this kind of firewall. So actually what you find is that the applications, the virtualized applications, are not protected the way physical workloads were protected. And now with these containers and VMs, you can. So the answer to your question is that MidoNet does help secure both east-west traffic, so traffic from VM to VM, and north-south traffic, meaning traffic from or to the internet, between the internet and VMs, by working with partners and other projects.
So I had a question that, you know, you guys have been talking back and forth, and I've had a few minutes to think about this, and we actually had a similar question from the audience. So let me just go to the chat room to Chumley, who says, can you deploy this on Cisco or Juniper? And I want to know that, but I also want to know how this competes with Cisco and Juniper, because I think they have software that does has similar type of functionality as well, right?
They do. So let me start with the question about it's on Cisco. we love kids. So when the way I'm going to interpret that question is, can we deploy MidoNet's hardware switch agent on a Cisco switch? So that's something that we really want to do, but we haven't had time to investigate fully. It looks like there are now Cisco switches that can that allow arbitrary Python daemons to run, and so we could offer similar functionality. I haven't identified exactly what subset might not be what we might not be able to implement, but that's something that we've thought about but not done yet. It's also a little bit of a strategy question. Although it's clear that Cisco is dominant in the market and there's a lot of Cisco fabrics, we are often in greenfield deployments, and therefore it's a bit of an early bias that we work with the open switches and the open approach. Now, as for and the same goes for the Juniper hardware networking. Now, as for the competition, so Juniper has a very popular software-defined network for OpenStack and container environments, and I think they both have vSphere solutions, as do we. So the Juniper product is called Juniper Contrail, and they have an open source project called Open Contrail. Very nice project. So we're direct competitors there, and so we see Juniper Contrail at customer POCs. And the approach is, at the end of the day, for some environments, you're doing the same. You're providing neutron networking. The feature sets might be a little different, and the advantages are a little different. But again, lots of similarities between the projects, because ultimately they're trying to sort of implement neutron and fix the problems of the neutron reference implementations. Cisco. We don't see as much of Cisco in OpenStack, not of Cisco. Sort of Cisco has the Nexus 1000V is the traditional software switch that existed before OpenStack in vSphere.
I know they have. Well, I was just thinking mostly of Cisco's UCS system, because I know they do some of this. And I'm sure that they would argue that they do a lot of it, but I know they do some of this in UCS, where you can even move hardware around, and when you do, it picks up the profile of that system when you put it back into the system and all that kind of stuff. So that's kind of what I was thinking of is more UCS than in their switching products directly.
I think it's also worth mentioning Cisco's ACI, application centric infrastructure. So
yes.
Cisco and some other vendors have very intelligent fabrics that can be configured. So you can think of the fabric basically. So another one that is certainly worth mentioning is Big Switch Networks, and they have fabrics that are configurable. Now you can use these fabrics to directly control virtual workloads. Normally, then you also install a software. An agent, a software switch in the hypervisor.
Cool. But there's nothing really that would prevent you from running both this, I mean alongside on or, you know, next to Cisco's gear, right? I mean, there's no preclusion from you like, oh, you can't run this with Juniper. You can't run this with Cisco. It has to be white box, right?
Not at all. In fact, you know, there are good reasons to do so. So for one thing, the fact that we sort of chose very early on to just be agnostic, you know, all we require is that you give us a layer three network. You know, it could be a layer three network on a single rack, or it could be a layer three network that spans a data center. That's all we need to work with. And a reason to use something like so Cisco's ACI. Some people worry, but Cisco's ACI is doing its own encapsulation and tunneling, and they do that in order to control the path that they take from one top of rack, or from one leaf in the spine and leaf topology, from one leaf to the other. But ultimately, what it's trying to do is sort of they can also do policies, but the way I think of it, or the way we talk to, you know, our users and customers, is to sort of say ACI is very good at configuring physical networks. So you want to take physical servers and isolate them from each other, and you can do all that via Cisco ACI. But you can still get a lot of benefit from running MidoNet at the edge, because then you're doing, you know, our security policy, our service chaining, our port mirroring. We also have a lot of visibility, since we can see exactly how the flow is treated at the edge. We can provide flow records that tell you exactly what's happening on the overlay.
Whoops! I turned on my mute because my dog was barking. I apologize. apparently, I'm getting some Amazon deliveries here, one right after the other. So I apologize for that. So we're talking about Cisco. I want to get back to. One more question, and then I want to get back to the project itself and talk about what license this is under, and talk about, you know, who's contributing and all of that. We don't want to forget that. This is, after all, the open source show. But one more question I was really curious about, which is, what if I've got a network running in my physical data center locally, and that's important, right, for maybe my production workload or whatever, some reason, can't run this in the cloud, or I've got my own cloud services defined, or private clouds maybe that I stood up locally in my data center. But then I've got these pieces that I do want to run in the cloud. I want to run on Amazon. I want to run on Azure or SoftLayer. Can I bring my MidoNet software and configuration with me to the cloud? Or do I have to change things up in order to run on the cloud?
That's a question that hasn't been settled entirely. So you're going to get a different answer depending on whom you ask. So our position has been that various clouds have different ways of doing policy and networking. And there are layers like Clicker or Scalar, I think. There are various, let's call them cloud aggregators. Essentially, you write to the API. I think maybe there's one called libcloud, but you write to an API that is generically addressing infrastructure. And in that API, you might point to a certain cloud and say, I want these resources to be on AWS or on Azure. And then it will configure and translate those requests into the native API of the platform. So you could in that way combine. You could write your application so that you can deploy it to OpenStack and Azure and AWS, but have the orchestration be agnostic to the actual cloud. Now, the difficulty with that is that you may be reducing yourself to a lowest common denominator. So what we see customers doing is they use those things, or they just say, you know what, it's not that bad to write the orchestration a few times. It's not that much code. And then I can really use very specific functionality in the different clouds. So we think that either of those two approaches makes sense, because these clouds have functionality that, you know, from the bare metal all the way up, the layers of the software, of the hardware and software stack. What we're seeing some vendors doing is that they are introducing agents in the cloud. That's if you want to apply the policy that you're doing in the data center, and you're going to deploy VMs and you're going to run our agent, or you know, sort of an SDN agent in the cloud, we don't generally recommend running MidoNet in AWS, for example, because then you're getting two layers of security. You know, the AWS has security groups, it has ACLs, and you're getting two layers of encapsulation. So we tunnel traffic between endpoints and maybe you're going through Amazon's SDN. Actually, I don't think Amazon is using overlays, but you don't really know what's going on in Amazon's network. So this is something that's evolving. I think what's lacking is really the use cases. So you ask, you know, as you what is the architecture? It's really important to ask, how are you splitting your application across the two clouds? So what some people are doing, for example, is they build a completely separate deployment in the two clouds. So really, it's you know, at some point they'll do DNS load balancing, meaning if your customers or clients make a DNS query for your domain name, they get a different IP address to talk to, depending on where they're located. They get the closest one or the least loaded one. But once they go into that cloud and your provisioned applications there, they stay there. It's just the traffic might bounce around between, you know, of course we know that, especially with microservices architectures, but for a decade now, I mean, people don't have monolithic applications anymore. You have interactions between VMs, between containers, and so there's a lot of bouncing around within the cloud before an answer is produced and sent back to the client. Now, do you really want that answer or that computation to be composed by crossing clouds? So people don't generally do that. The only interactions the interactions we see most commonly are that there's a snapshot of a database being moved over, or there's a synchronization or a distributed database that needs to do continuous synchronization at the object level. Of course, then there's a use case where you sort of fail over. But migration of a VM from one cloud to another, you know, we don't subscribe to that, because you know, you should be building your application so that you can lose the VM locally. And the other, you know, if it's a database, you have a copy. And if it's a stateless component, well, then it's stateless and you don't need to move it. And therefore, instead of moving a VM, you just use the elastic scaling techniques that are available in all of the clouds. So, you know, Kubernetes has replication controllers. OpenStack has Heat, a project that orchestrates virtual machines, and you can specify scaling parameters, you know, based on CPU or other kinds of load of load indicators. OpenStack has elastic load balancing and elastic scaling and so on.
Great. So I also wanted to ask, and we're running out of time, and we've got a couple more questions, but Strengths in the chat room says, have governments approached MidoNet to run their internet filters? He puts it internet filters. And I wanted to ask something similar to that, which is, you know, what are customers doing with this? If you have any brief examples, but let's get to the first one. Is this something that the government would pick up and use, or would they be more likely to stick with the proprietary closed source? Sometimes it works. It's odd with the government. Sometimes they choose the open source because they get it, and sometimes they choose the proprietary because they don't, and they want the perceived reliability of proprietary vendors. So, right. What do you think?
So we've had sort of school districts, several cases, and university. There's a project in Australia called Nectar, and it's a research cloud that spans many universities. I think they have 100 sites in Australia. So we see sort of education adopting OpenStack and other virtual workload orchestration aggressively. Now we don't have as much. Requests from government, and I think it is because they're more they're more likely to use traditional techniques and the traditional platforms that are more mature. But then again, that hasn't been our maybe not so much the focus of our sales or our outreach even in the open source. And Aaron, what was your second question?
Well, that's actually, that answers that. I mean, I was just wondering what other customers are if you can tell us what other customers are using MidoNet.
Sure. So we see basically, I'd say sort of 50-50, and it's actually probably gone to more towards the enterprise. So web scale companies. So, you know, a few examples are ancestry.com, we have Overstock, a retail website. Cerner is a great example. Cerner is a medical system software as a service. But then we also have providers like Blue Jeans Network, runs MidoNet. It's a voice over IP system. And then public cloud providers like Oro and Zeta. So small public cloud providers that compete with the bigger players. What's that composition? So we expected to see more cloud providers adopt OpenStack, actually, not just MidoNet, but adopt OpenStack. And we're seeing that often the public cloud providers, big or small, and once they build a platform, it's very sticky. So some entered early and built their own stacks, and it's taking them a while to go and adopt OpenStack. Enterprises have, you know, of course, there's a huge range of enterprises, but enterprises have been more aggressive in at least trying out and moving some workloads onto OpenStack, and now we see a lot of experimentation with Kubernetes. Some production, but it's still something that they're grappling with.
Is this something fast enough for Strength asked this question in the chat room? Is this something fast enough for like financial companies, banks, and things like that? Is there any reason they wouldn't want to run something using MidoNet?
So yes, it is. It is absolutely fast. So I'm going to talk about sort of both the platforms and MidoNet, right? So. The financials would run either a container as a service, you know, Kubernetes or OpenStack, and certainly in the OpenStack community, we've seen for two reasons, but because of the virtualization of network functions, there's OPNFV, the Open Platform for Network Function Virtualization, with OpenStack as the reference cloud management system. But there's been a huge effort to say, are we ready for the high performance? Are we ready for packet switching with guaranteed, you know, with for time-sensitive workloads, low latency? The software, both at the software layer and the reference architectures, making sure that we are using the correct capabilities that are provided by the CPUs. Definitely, these projects have come sort of a long way in the last few years, and they are doing things like, you know, they're running. They're running high performance computing, for example. So that was maybe you can do that independently of the network layer because there's something called single root I/O virtualization allows you to give a virtual machine basically a queue on a NIC or direct access to a NIC. So what often we do is we tell customers that overlay does introduce latency, and therefore, if you have some very some high performance requirements, and often they're very specific, like, you know, you have a multicast, an interface that receives multicast. So, if customers that might have an interface on which they do their routed traffic and then an internet requests, and on another interface they'll do multicast or they'll do high performance computing. And often those are isolated networks, or, you know, certainly not connected to the internet. So what we can do is sort of, you know, OpenStack has this great feature, and Neutron has this great feature that you can actually combine SDNs. So you can use an SDN that just ties the and there are several, but you can just tie the VM's interface, one of its interfaces, directly to the NIC. That would be not the overlay, and therefore have fewer of the overlay features, but you get very high performance because the SDN gets out of the way. And then on your routed interface, you could apply all the security policies and port mirroring and et cetera, et cetera.
Cool. We are running a little bit late here, so we're going to do something that I like to call the lightning round, where I ask you the last few questions that I really want to know before we have to wrap up. So you have to give me either a single answer or a short sentence, and we'll wrap the show up really quick. But I know that our audience is really anxious to get a couple more questions in before we wrap. So the first one is, what license does MidoNet use?
It's the Apache license.
Apache license. Is there any reason that you chose Apache specifically? This can be longer than one sentence answer. Is there any reason that Apache specifically was the license you guys chose?
We looked at various licenses, but primarily the flexibility of the license, but also the communities that we work with are primarily Apache license.
Perfect. And now that leads me to my next answer, or my next lightning round question. How do you contribute to the project? Is this a project that's contributed mostly by the Midokura as a company, or do the people that use MidoNet, do they actually contribute back? What does the contributor ecosystem look like?
It's almost entirely dominated by MidoNet. We do get bug fixes and participation in sort of design or feature requests from users. But primarily, and this has been sort of a failure on our part to sort of to open the project up more, to get more interest in the project. There's also just a lot of competition in the space right now. So a lot of open source projects, and they have
awesome. Go ahead.
No, that's all.
Oh, that was it. Okay. Next lightning round question: how do people get involved with MidoNet?
Oh, so we have midonet.org. So if you go on midonet.org, it's actually a great website, and we have users that are very happy with it. I'd say you can find a getting started where with a single script, you can get a single node OpenStack that has MidoNet running and all the tools. You can also find vendors like Ubuntu and Red Hat and Mirantis have open source projects. So Juju for Canonical and Red Hat has I'm forgetting the name of the project. I'll say Mirantis has Fuel, and yes, it's called Red Hat OpenStack Platform. But they all have installers, and you can find open source versions of the installers, and you can find the Kubernetes MidoNet. Also, these are all available in the open source.
Awesome. And then where can people, you kind of answered this a little bit already, but last question, where do people find out more, not just from a contributor standpoint, but also from, hey, I just want to, is there a tutorial somewhere that I can follow to get this set up? Can I try it in my, in my basement somewhere with a couple of servers? Where's the best place for people to go to get started learning about MidoNet?
Right, absolutely. And it's really easy to get started. You go to midonet.org, we have a blog. Midokura.com also has blogs and tutorials, but midonet.org has a series of blogs that explain the internals. Essentially, you're sort of depending on whether you're using this in Kubernetes or OpenStack, you're going to need to learn to use those systems. And really, you're only interacting with MidoNet if things go wrong, right? Or if you want to use some advanced functionality.
Awesome. Last lightning round question. This is kind of an open one. Anything that we didn't talk about that you might want to let our audience know that we didn't cover or just didn't have time to mention? Anything? Any last thoughts about MidoNet or something you want to tell the audience?
Nothing comes to mind right now.
Great. I mean, this is like so fascinating. And the thing about it is it touches so many different parts of the infrastructure that we use on a daily basis. I don't think people realize it. So congratulations on this project. I know I had heard of it, but wasn't really aware that it had been around so long. 2010, I think you said it started, or maybe a little earlier.
So maybe I'll say a few words about that. So Midokura started in 2010, but actually we didn't open source the project until late 2014. And I think that's and when we did open source the project, actually things started to go much better for us, because even vendors pushed for open sourcing MidoNet, and we were worried about it. And so I think this is a lesson for other companies and for myself certainly, that there are so many benefits to open sourcing. We get business by being in a community, and therefore by contributing back, not just to the community's projects, but by opening up more of our technology, you make it easier for people to try out your stuff and to trust, to look inside You're also making a statement about the way you want to interact and collaborate with people. It's a bit of culture, and it's also a bit, of course, of strategy and working process.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm really glad you were able to mention that, because it's something that you brought up at the very beginning of the show, and I was like writing it down. I want to get back to that question. How do you transition into an open source? One last thing real quickly, because I think this is so important. Any learning that you could share with other people who might be in companies that have proprietary code and are resistant to open sourcing or moving it into an open source model? Is there any learning that you got from going through that process?
Yes, I think so. I mean, I think there are certainly fields where there might be some really secret sauce that you need to protect. And you can usually find ways to protect that. But a huge amount of our code that we write is in secret sauce. And often, especially when you start to see the field become a bit more crowded, also you do a service to your customers as well. Our concerns had been around investors, around protecting IP, around preparing for future funding rounds. And in fact, none of that ended up mattering. We were surprised at how much easier things got when we open sourced.
That's awesome. I think that's a great message to share with other companies, and congratulations on that's why I hadn't heard of it, is because it was only 2014, even though you have such a long history in doing this. So congratulations on going that route on behalf of all the end users. It really helps all of us when companies open up their code. And it helps the company out too, as you mentioned. There's a couple last questions we always ask all of our guests. And the first one is, what is your favorite scripting language?
My favorite scripting language. You know, we're a Python shop, so I'm going to have to say Python.
Awesome. I love Python. I'm teaching my kids Python right now. They wanted to learn programming. I said, oh, we're going to learn Python. So that's a great answer. And then the second question is, what's your favorite editor, text editor?
Oh, text editor. Well, I use the IntelliJ IDEA.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I've used that before as well. So that's awesome. I know that we get so many different answers, and this is something that's like the most illuminating to me is what people use on a regular basis. It's just like one or two. It's like there's like 100 ones out there. Some people use IDEs.
Yep. And I'll just chime in that. So it's really wonderful to see that organizations, I mean, I think our company's just representative in this regard. I mean, developers are able to take the tools that they want nowadays. So, you know, we have Eclipse and IntelliJ IDEA, and then we have the Emacs users and the Vim users that are doing amazing things despite using tools that were created a long time ago, because the tools are also still flexible and they can apply color schemes and advanced autocomplete, stuff I don't understand. Those guys I have a lot of respect for.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Well, Pino De Candia, thank you so much for coming on and sharing a little bit about MidoNet and Midokura. I really appreciate it.
Aaron, it was a pleasure. I'm honored to have been on the show.
Awesome. Awesome. Now go get some dinner. I know it's late over there. We'll talk to you later. Jonathan, what do you think?
Well, I think we got our answer. There might be just a little bit more to it than buzzwords and VLANs. It sounds like one of the big things that they're doing is they want to abstract away, which that's an important concept in programming, is that of abstraction. You know, you don't want to have to worry about writing assembly code when you want a GUI or something like that. So they're trying to abstract away parts of the networking so that every engineer doesn't have to worry about it. I think that's a neat idea. There's definitely a future in that.
Absolutely. And not only that, but even if the code is complicated, as we were just discussing, I mean, how complicated could this be? And it's kind of our a tangled mess of our own making, just how the industry developed from using, you know, token ring and then Ethernet and then virtual networks. And you have to do something for all of the virtual hosts that you have, and now you have containers, and it just gets more and more complicated. And so this really addresses a problem. But as you were saying, you know, you even though the underlying aspects are very complicated, the solution, especially as it's presented to the user, does not have to be. And oh, by the way, you can do all this with open source. So I totally agree with what you're saying. I mean, this is what blows my mind is how complicated this set of problems can be and how the solution actually can solve that for in a lot of ways. So really fascinating stuff. I know we talked a lot today, and we do need to move on. But speaking of moving on, next week, as I mentioned at the beginning of the episode, we're going to have Josh Berkus on, and we're going to have a great, lovely co-host, Randall Schwartz, will be joining us first time back since he's been away on medical leave. And it's going to be great to have him back. We're so glad he's doing well. But he's going to be back to talk with Josh Berkus and I about Project Atomic. And they describe this as immutable infrastructure to, and you have to say it that way, by the way, immutable infrastructure to deploy and scale your containerized applications on a next generation container OS. I think this is a great idea to have an OS specifically for containers and projects that use containers. So that's going to be really interesting to talk to him. And then on September 20th, Jared Smith is going to join us. He's going to be talking about Capital One open source. What does a bank do with open source? Find out on that episode. And then on October 4th, we've got Jesse Noller coming on to talk about Karina. It's an easy to use instant on native container environment, again with the containers, instant Docker swarm, literally is what they say. So that's going to be really interesting. All this cool stuff going on. I can't believe it. Jonathan, anything you want to plug before we wrap up here?
Just an interesting note, the episode coming up next week with Josh. From what I remember, that's actually one of Randall's, if not the first guest that Randall interviewed was Josh Berkus. And so
that's
it's
right.
going to
it
kind of
actually,
be a reunion for them.
Yeah, he was on episode, it was one of the early episodes. If I had time, I'd look it up. It was like episode 6 or 16 or something very, very early. And Randall was on as a co-host, filling in at that point. And he was on as a co-host, and Josh was the first guest that he actually interviewed as a co-host on Floss Weekly. So a little bit of history there as well. As far as I'm concerned, you can definitely follow me on Google Plus or on Twitter or on Facebook, whatever you want. I'm Aaron Newcomb on all of those networks. So look me up there. I've got a new book coming out. It's called Linux for Makers. Hopefully I'll get that out by Christmas. It's going to be really cool if you're new to the Raspberry Pi or kind of hesitant to use it because you have to learn a little bit about Linux. This book is going to help you out. So stay tuned for that. As far as this show is concerned, you can follow us on Twitter as well. We're at Floss Weekly plus Floss Weekly on Google Plus. You can also participate in the chat room. It's irc.twit.tv, and you can watch us live at live.twit.tv. It's almost always more fun. I say almost because you never know what's going to happen when you participate live as the shows are going on, because you can talk to other people and talk to us. We respond directly in the chat room, where we always try to ask your questions in the chat room. So that's going to wrap it up for this week. We'll see you next time on Floss Weekly.